Ooh. Sexy names.
Okay, can you see the screen?
Got it.
So can you see the sitting on the fence screen? Is that showing up?
Not on mine.
No, not yet. There it goes, Mark. Coming up. There you go.
Okay. Anyway, all so right. The format of this is we have two of our 79 artists, Rob Evans and Rick Leonardi, and the format of it will be Rob will spend about 25 or 30 minutes talking about his work, and Rick will be interviewing and conversing with him during that time, and then they will switch roles. So I'm going to try to keep the intros really quick. Rob Evans is a muralist, 79, from Hitchcock Dorm, and right now he comes to us from California within view of the Sierra Nevada mountains. Rick Leonardi is an American comic book illustrator from Streeter Dorm, and tonight he's in Pennsylvania near Philadelphia. Rob was a visual studies major, studied at Oxford at the Ruskin School of Fine Art, then in London, and since then he's worked in the United States. And then Rick has been drawing for Cloak and Dagger, Spider-Man, and he's working, and we'll see this at the end, an original graphic novel that's been sponsored by the U.S. Naval Institute called The Blue Angel. But anyway, the last thing I want to say is you're about to, if I can paraphrase Rob Serling, this is a vast dimension, as vast as space and as timeless as infinity. This is the middle ground between light and shadow, between science and superstition, and it lies between the pits of man's fears and the summit of his knowledge. This is the dimension of imagination. It is an area which we will call the twilight zone of 1979 artists. And with that, I pass that over to our first speaker, Rob Evans.
Hello. I guess we're waiting for some slides. I'm going to give you a very quick overview of about 30 years of work, try to touch all the bases without touching all the work. Starting with student work at Dartmouth, I have about 70 slides, and I'm starting with only two pieces from Dartmouth, not necessarily my favorite work, but maybe the most relevant to what I do now, and that's a Trompe l'Oeil painting, which is an attempt to fool the perception of the viewer into thinking what they're seeing are actual objects on an actual surface. It is a surface, but it's all paint. And it's this piece is 12 by 16. You go to the next slide, I expanded the format to a larger piece, which is mimicking a shirt on a hanger with my dad's old fur vest. That was quite a taxing piece to paint because of all that fur. And in this one, the hanger is real, the collar is extruded, but everything else is flat, the accessories, the clothing, and so forth. Remember that fur there, because I'll talk about it later in another slide in a different context. We're switching now quickly to Mark grayed out a section in Photoshop to show what happens when scenic art takes over. And that was kind of my first official job, was doing stuff like this, which is another kind of illusion, architectural illusion, in this case, a cinematic or a cinema of frontage with an actual rectangle cut out of it to go through. This was a conference for John Hancock where they hosted folks from all over the city. And there was about 8 or 10 of these things. This is kind of looking at what people see from a distance and using all kinds of faux finishing tricks, which are also applied to marble, brick, and other things. This is where I learned how to work on a big scale and do it quickly. Next slide. There we have Cena Studios. And this scene was used as a flyer, an advertising flyer for the studio. The lead ballerina of Boston Ballet was supposed to be the person in it. She called in sick, and so they drafted me in a trench coat and sunglasses coming through the door into a kind of a sort of a intergalactic henchman into a world that is loaded with scenic effects. The architecture on the left, the perspective with the floor, and then the kind of light effect shining through a scrim on the back with a kind of asteroid belt. Not all of this painting is mine, but some of it is. I was just doing what the house wanted. And again, we switching, if you remember that hairstyle, I went back to a really bad one here, the Dumb and Dumber. This is later, my usual kind of look. One of my first murals, and I'm doing actually Trompe L'Oeil on a local part of the scene here on the lichen, which then reads against the deep view, which is a big landscape. Go to the next slide. That kind of work led to more private commissions. And this is a one that was at the New Hampshire Historical Society in Concord, New Hampshire. It's a fire tower theme where you start at the bottom like this and work your way up the stairs. You're below tree line, then suddenly you come out onto a view of the valley. Now hold that slide for a second. I was talking, oh, back to the last one. That the trees there are like the fir in a way in the previous painting, but much on a vaster scale with the same kind of sameness overall, but a great deal of variety in that. And you really can't cut corners. And then when I take the mist with a spray gun and go over it, you risk screwing the whole thing up, days of work. And luckily this one worked out okay. You get past this view to the top, next slide, see through to Franconia Notch, and ultimately that's the view without obstruction of the notch, and kind of resembles a painting that was near it in the first slide, which was a Hudson River school, an apt juxtaposition. Go to the next set here. We're going to the aquarium. Now, jobs like that last one really came out of more local jobs to Boston, two places in particular, New England Aquarium and Museum of Science. I've done a lot of work for the aquarium over the years. This is a section of an Everglades mural, about 60 feet long, the total mural. This is just a detail. And all of these murals had live critters in front of them, one kind or another. We can go to the next slide now. This is another detail. I don't have great shots of, these are all-
We have audio, this is-
Sorry? Anyway, this is a Acadia National Park scene, me circa the sort of early 90s. And it's in front of a tidal, or behind a tidal pool. So the kids touch and interact with small creatures and then see the larger context of the environment that they came from. That's the idea. A lot of the usual bells and whistles for that area, like the seals and gulls and whatnot, are in it. Next slide. Different kind of interactive thing where the 3D parts are inserted. Somebody's battery is running low. Mine is plugged in, so I don't know what's going on. I hope that's not. Are inserted as vignettes into the 2D scene, a ponds mural here, above and below water. We can go to the next slide. Next slide, Mark. This is just to show you the end result, how it appears, the murals. That's an 85-foot Bahamas scene that sort of sets off smaller, more local areas where the kids, in this case, are touching and interacting with skates and small sharks. And so that's just to show you the sort of destiny, what my murals end up in the aquarium most often, how they look kind of as a big general scene. Next slide. I think we're going now to the Museum of Science, where a very old mural of a human cell. This is pretty much straightforward illustration of a sort of diagrammatic kind. It kind of makes microscopic space look like macroscopic outer space. We have all the usual parts of the cell, nucleus, mitochondria. And I had fun with this. It's about 12 by 20. And one of my earliest pieces there, next slide, at Museum of Science. Now this, another kind of illustration, it's in a section they call the discovery section. And the discovery here is that of Lascaux by a local French kid. I forget when it was, earlier this last century, and you know, illuminating the wall. And I mean, I almost didn't show this, but it seems to be that Lascaux is an important thing to me, and for different reasons. This is, you know, in and of itself, not that particular shot. I've lost the slide show right now. Is that possible? I don't see pictures anymore.
Mark, where's the slides?
Yeah, we lost the slides.
This is what they call technical difficulty.
I think we lost Mark.
Maybe it's an opportunity for you to, Rick, to ask me a question. I don't know. Maybe not. We'll see.
I think we lost Mark. Maybe it was his computer that was low. So yeah. Let's go.
I was actually struck by you talked about Trump Loy and used the word illusion. Which it is. But by the time you're doing this, the aquarium work, you're starting to talk more in terms of interactivity and involving the viewer in an actual partnership. I wonder if you see that as a kind of maturation of your attitude a little bit, getting out of
It's partly a maturation of what was required of me in the job, just working large scale and a different kind of interaction, but a different kind of illusion, I guess. The success in my world is more about the artist disappearing. And yes, the viewer is key. There is no barrier, hopefully, between the viewer and the work.
Exactly.
And I suppose I'm imagining what I would want to see as a viewer for that particular subject and doing it as best I can.
And Trump Loy, I mean, properly, one way to understand Trump Loy is it's actually more or less of a stunt. You know, it's a trick.
It's true. It can be like a one-liner. It's like a one-liner, and it's a narrow straitjacket for paint. But it's also a way to learn the medium.
What you're trying to do is create an experience. You're trying to create an environment for a viewer, which is a very much more welcoming and caring almost relationship that you're setting up between yourself as an artist and anybody who stumbles upon your art, which I think that's fine. I like that.
Thank you. The funny thing is my name isn't usually retained by the viewers if the work succeeds, because they just think of it as a background. And you, by contrast, are a star in a sense, because your name, you know, the word Leonardesque doesn't apply to just one guy anymore. You are, a known, your art style versus your style versus previous Spider-Man guys and everything, you know, you have, you're in a tradition, and, you know, it's great. I love it. And it sort of made me think about actually picking up comic books again.
We'll get to this, but
can I ask a quick question?
So hang on, guys. So Mark is coming on in another computer. So we should have slides back any minute.
Right.
I have a question, Rob. You talked about your work in the aquarium. Did they have to take special measures to waterproof your work so that it would survive in that?
Yeah, I did my best. In some cases, like the tidal pool mirror, that was on sheetrock. It was separated by 2 or 3 feet, but splashing over the years caused severe decay, required repair a few times. The last slide I showed of the Bahamas scene, you know, that the skates and the sharks rubbed up against the bottom of it and kind of wiped it clean. And then when there was an algae bloom at one point, they had to empty the tank. I had an opportunity to go in and kind of do a surgical repair. But yeah, those murals, they're temporary for the most part at the aquarium, exhibit to exhibit. And it is very hard to maintain the quality over time. And in fact, there have been a couple of underwater murals where I experimented with waterproof, you know, marine paint and stuff. And they lasted okay for, you know, a year or so. But that's true pretty much, not just of saltwater situations, but when you have kids close by, touching walls and stuff, you have to be aware of that. You're back, Mark. Oh, here we go.
Oh, it's going. We're there.
Oh, it sounds like we're back on board here.
Yes,
I'm going to demand that 10 minutes be tacked onto my presentation.
Absolutely.
All right, let's go. So we can get back to the theme here, or Lascaux and its importance, maybe, because we've had a little talk about that already. Let's go to the next slide. Okay, now we're at the Springfield Science Museum. Okay, that's Boston Museum Science, Springfield, Mass. And this mural is a background of an old growth forest circa 1000 BC, which serves as a kind of backdrop for an exhibit about a soapstone quarry that Native Americans used in what is now Wilbraham, Mass. I like this mural for one reason. It's like a grove. It's a grove, and it's I think of the origins of religious temples like the Parthenon, which were based on groves, big tall trees, canopies. The trunks are the columns. You know, the canopy is the capital, and it's a kind of pre-religious religion, if you like, that is in the back of my head a lot when I work on forest scenes and woodlands. And here we're talking about forest that doesn't really exist anymore. It's trying to look like old growth. You can go to the next slide. That's me in action for a press shot. And interesting story here, the figure was a Polish laborer in the 30s that they used as the model. You can see the paint chipping off the plaster. I had to repair that as well. But this was just kind of a pose shot. I'm not actually painting. I'm faking painting there. I think I can tell just by what I'm doing. But it was just a press shot to see things in action. Next slide. Also at the Museum of Science, I got into some fairly standard issue evolution stuff. It's a little weak on design because I was cramming so much into about 4 billion years into 20 feet. And has a lot of borrowing, shall we say, or more like stealing. As someone said, Picasso or somebody, you know, good artists don't borrow, they steal. But this is one section. The next slide will show you how I, Mark, you can go to the next slide. Just used dividers and sort of the graphics tell you where you are in time and as the different flora and fauna kind of parade above, in and between periods. Next slide. Okay, this is a mural that was important because it generated a lot of work for me, not strangely natural history or biological illustration or anything, but it's a cyclorama that was at the Madison, Wisconsin Children's Museum, and it's above and below water. It's about 8x40, which for a cyclorama is a very tight diameter. So I couldn't really shoot it at once. I did it in sections. This first slide I'll dwell on the most because it shows all the things going on. A lot of playing with scale, as if you shift frames of reference every time you look at a new critter. You can go to the next slide now. That perch, for instance, about 3 to 4 feet long. Then you wonder, well, what's the mussel shell and the crawfish doing so big? And it's partly to say, well, they could be way in front of it and you could be the size of a tiny aphid or something. There's that kind of thing going on. So there's a little bit of surrealism. You go to the next slide. We just whipped through this one with the frog. Steve Abbott, brother of our classmate Ames, was nice enough to take these shots after the mural came down. He shot this one on the floor from a ladder. He was out in Madison at the time, and also a visual studies man. Next slide, pike and goose. Okay, so there you have it, up and above and below water, a common theme as I go through. Next slide, let's see, where are we here? Okay. I travel a lot for murals. This is a mural that traveled on the Mass Department of Environmental Management van. It depicted the two ends of two sides of Massachusetts, the mountain on the west and the mountains, the Berkshires, and then the coastal scene. You can go to the next slide, which shows the sort of jumble. It's a bit of a Where's Waldo thing where kids have to look in all this massive material to find stuff. And in the middle and distance, you may see a little girl behind a rock. This is also a kind of discovery theme like the Lascaux mural. Basically illustration in a way. And this would be the coastal scene on the other side. And then we can go to a detail of it. Next slide shows you similar to what I was doing before. You know, above and below water, detail that they can see right on the van. And we go to the next slide and see where we are here. Okay, that's the kids experiencing it. And that kid on the left pointing is out of central casting. It means the mural is working, I guess. next mural. Now, this was a sort of maybe bigger, more major statement, which was at the Woodland Park Zoo in Seattle in 1995. It was a Alaskan tundra scene. I got to go to Denali to research it. It goes from morning to evening and spring to winter. This is the central summer noon section, so to speak. Shows you it's about 11 feet high by 70 and has graphics and a soundtrack to go with it. We can go to the next slide where you'll see the right side of the mural, which is kind of spring and morning. And it has heavy weather, a lot of snow, as it did when I was there, even in June. And the detail is the doll sheep, which is probably maybe 4-5 inches tall, something like that, maybe six. Shows you the kind of relationship of the small and the large. Next slide. And we got Arctic fox summer phase. I think it's an Arctic hare summer phase. And the next slide is a vireo. What I like about this one is the mark making and the brushwork of the background, kind of what we call facture. It's the act of making as revealed in the stroke, in a sense. That kind of sets up the middle thing, but it's in a way as important or more important as an expressionistic device. You know, you can't have everything in focus that way. You need to set it off. And that's fun stuff to do. I mean, you know, you're drawing on a lot of different traditions when you do that. And the close-up, it shows intention, but it's not composed in any, I mean, the strokes could be quite a bit different, but have the same effect. Anyway, next slide. We'll go from this piece to, that's the in-progress shot of that mural. I'm holding a big brush. That means it's early. And my look is telling me, you know, I've been working all day and what did I get done? It doesn't look like anything's happening. My son, Seth, who was 2 at the time, picked up a brush. He's not even a lefty, but it looks like a very authentic guy working on a brush stroke there. And he's a good artist and now is a musician as well. More of a musician, I guess, than an artist, visual artist. But that's just shows you kind of a little vignette, personal interest kind of thing. Next slide. Okay, this is the biggest project I've ever worked on in terms of square footage. And it was the Great Platte River Road Memorial Monuments in Kearney, Nebraska. It's basically a covered bridge, 2-story, that they hung over the interstate. It was so late, the construction, that other artists had to be pulled in. And my designs, all the designs were, in some cases, they suffered. The sky here, for instance, has a sort of Disney-esque quality, but the rays of God are all wobbly. Everything kind of went wrong there. But I painted stuff from the horizon down. The theme of this museum is westward migration, particularly the Oregon Trail. And this is a scene coming out of Fort Kearney towards Chimney Rock, which is a well-known landmark. You can go to the next slide, which shows, this is just showing what my approach, based on the fact that everything was late. I did about 10 murals offsite, rolled them up and shipped them. So the Wyoming landscape you see on the left, about 16 by 16 on a rolling platform, was shipped and then installed on what you see on the right. And the figures are myself, my wife, and a girl who was the daughter of the woman who supplied us with the outfits. And we're standing in front of a 3-dimensional grave. You know, this is a tragic scene. If you see the movie About Schmidt, Jack Nicholson stands in front of this mural for a few seconds. The museum was completed just a little bit before that movie was made. So the director, forget if it was Cameron Crowe or who, used it as a convenient set for the movie. Next slide. This is an isolated kind of theme, not monumental figures. I don't get to paint that often. And it's an example of the advent of digital printing. This was done for a painting to scale, maybe 1/6 the size. This is actually about 18 by 50, something like that. Figures are quite big. It's a commemorative mural about Forbes Field for the Western Pennsylvania Sports Museum in Pittsburgh. And it has great Pirates players. You might recognize Roberto Clemente, Willie Stargell, Bill Mazeroski, and Hannes Wagner. But it was all print. Yeah, and so the print theme continues. These are more ethnographic paintings of Kenosha Public Museum in Kenosha, Wisconsin. This is about a 12 by 15 mural print on the right that is modeled on the painting from the left, is recreated from that painting. And it's Aztalan, so named by an archaeologist, based on the mythical homeland of the Mississippian culture. And this is the uppermost settlement of that culture. They were mound builders, Cahokia Mound at that time was the largest settlement in North America, maybe about 40,000 people. This is a much smaller provincial version of that culture. And what I'd like to, well, you can just, okay, just wanted to say that trying to bring in a sense of randomness of daily life is the challenge, not make the choreography look too obvious. I'm the guy there with the goose over his shoulder, and my wife and others are scattered throughout this mural. But things like the little kid, the baby whacking the dog, that kind of stuff, you try to give a snapshot of a moment as well as explain the larger issues of you know, the village and how they lived. Okay, next slide. This would be the Potawatomis. I did four seasonal murals about their life. This is a maple sugaring camp, and it's a bad slide, but the empty space on the right ended up with some exhibit scenery. We can go to the next slide. And then the winter scene, some casual activity. This is all family. My son did both kids on the left. That's me with the rabbits over. My mom looking at my wife who has the kindling. So for this moment, it was one big happy family. Next slide. I did a series. This is for the Mariners Museum in Newport News, Virginia. And it was we can go through these quickly, but it's basically a straightforward illustration of the Middle Passage and the dire conditions, the inhumanity and so forth. Little vignettes that you can go to the next one, we can go quickly through to show the flavor of it. Somewhat expressionistic, loose handling, because the way they were seen, and we can go to the next slide. Well, that's another one. Again, I modeled for many of these. And this is how they were painted on canvas in the studio as vignettes. They were then glued into an environment, next slide, which mimicked the ship hold, had sound effects. And this is a very bad slide, but it's the only one I have, showing and sound effects to sort of immerse the viewer in this kind of dreadful environment. And next slide. Okay, Mount Vernon Estate Museum. It's devoted to events in the life of George Washington, in this case, Valley Forge. And this is my scale painting background, which was about 1/5 scale. You can go to the next slide. And it was printed as a background like this. An interesting note here is that the equestrian figure, the horse and figure, it was about a $200,000 item, whereas the mural, I think, was under $15,000. So you can see the sort of budgetary ghetto that the visual artist sometimes gets into on this project. But the taxidermist here is a guy I've worked with a lot, and Frank Zitz out of Rhinebeck, New York. He has turned out to be a great referral source for me, and we cross paths often. That is true of a number of people in the business. Okay, next slide. Shows another background. This in this case, Mark inserted Washington's sword, which that is a cabinet in the exhibit, which shows his sword used in the Battle of Monongahela, which was lost by the Brits against the French during the French and Indian War. Washington himself was the only British officer to survive, and he ended up with many bullets in his pockets. His horse had been shot out from him. One of the natives said, you know, you have this magic guy on your side. We can't kill him. We tried to. We shot right at him. And imagine if they'd succeeded, you know, how history would have changed. But this is in a kind of a circular format. You can go to the next slide. It's just a detail of the same. And I won't tell you the sources for these images because I don't want to get into trouble. Again, you have to steal on certain budgets and schedules. No choice. Next slide. This is a kind of wacky version of the first inauguration at Federal Hall in Philadelphia, where Washington's being sworn in. And I was tasked with doing the background group. You can go to the next slide. This is just a test, a smaller version of it on vinyl. And it's a little, some of the heads don't quite fit the bodies, but what it was based on was I photographed a lot of reenactors in the Sudbury militia, and they were all very happy to be in this mural. A few in the middle are authentic guys like John Jay, Henry Knox, and others. But what happened was that the client, you can go to the next slide, Mark, wanted everybody to be authentic. And this was 5 minutes, 5 days before, it seemed like 5 minutes, 5 days before opening. And I had to go and remove people. You can see on the left, I'm painting them out and insert heads that sort of fit the bodies. I'm turning a guy named Pal Cutler into Henry Lee. And then you see him as Henry Lee on the right. And so it was a kind of Frankenstein maneuver, placing head research and then placing heads on bodies. And I got it done, and it was a very scary kind of high wire act. Next slide. Okay, this is a 13-foot painting, Everglades. It's another example of where print technology is going, because this was printed on a single piece of fabric, 16 feet high by 65 feet long. And it was not, so you can go to the next slide. Here you see it on site, the print, the lighting's a little different and everything. It's part of an airboat ride exhibit where it's down at the Museum of Discovery and Science in Fort Lauderdale. So if they drove about, and so yeah, hold on that one for a second, but they could actually go on a real airboat ride, but for some reason the museum wanted to do a fake one into a film kind of scene. This is just what I do at the end. I paint directly on the print, adding detail and some focus. That's kind of the fun part, turkey vulture and spoonbill. Next slide. Okay, Smith College Botanic Garden. I did a series of paintings that were sort of the history of plant life on Earth. This one is the first plants to kind of come up onto the Earth about 470 million years ago. The berm in front is like a stage where the sort of early primitive actors, if you like, are coming up and being lit up. And it was a volcanic environment, you know, a lot of gases in the air. And I'm just showing you this one. The next slide, we can see what I do at mock-ups to show the progress. As it turned out, it was up a ramp, so the images ended up being staggered. But we can go to the next slide. And that shows how confined the space is. It's a narrow corridor with basically a lot of humidity and outdoor conditions. So these prints are on an aluminum surface, and they're weatherproofed for outdoor, like outdoor signages in the parks. And this shows you just how the viewer never gets very far from these paintings. It's probably one of the most disadvantageous mural locations I've worked for. Anyway, next slide. We're getting into, sometimes, you know, it's not endless digital technology. I won an online competition to do a series of murals for the city of Laguna Hills and their city hall, local history mostly. This one is titled, I didn't choose the title, it's Discovering Orange County, which has a lot of manifest destiny implicit in the title, as if these guys, they were the scouts for the Portola expedition out of San Diego in 1769. They were Hispanic soldiers, and in some cases mestizo, called soldados de cuero, leather jackets. And we can go to the next slide. That's Saddleback Mountain in the background. That's me starting two of the murals on the left. This is me, hold this slide for a second, because this is as I'm getting further along on that one I just showed you. The rider in the middle, in a sense, it was very lucky. I got some research on him that he's a key figure. He sort of pulls this mural along, and in a way, the whole room along. And you can see the next slide, the source for that rider. I shot a guy, Jerry Cohen, a friend of a friend who has a ranch in the Hollywood Hills. He retired there after directing many episodes of Married with Children. I took probably 200 shots, and I got this one. He's wearing an outfit created by a very large reenactor. And so he's kind of swimming in it. It's too big for him. Generally, the problem with reenactors today is they are too big, too much pizza, beer, and so forth. They don't resemble the people in the past. So I trimmed him down and Hispanicized him a little. And it was a key, it was just an example, I added accessories, how one bit of research can really help you. And it's often hard to get it, or more than one, you know, say per picture. Okay, next slide. Okay, now we're down to the final project I'm showing you, which is in Bismarck, North Dakota. It's the Heritage Center and Museum, which covers a lot of history in its various exhibits. This is the beginning of one that is a cyclorama. This we'll hold with this one. This shows it closer to completion, a depiction of Double Ditch Village, one of the largest settlements of its time that Lewis and Clark visited. This is circa 1600. By the time they got there, disease was starting to wipe out, unfortunately, the population. Here, you'll see the sign to the left. I am part of the exhibit. In a sense, it's an exhibit about artists making exhibits. And I'm sort of a little bit of a caged animal. And I guess I would think of myself, if we're going to the next slide, well, not this one, but that's me going down the home stretch on, you know, just detail. This is the, sort of the fun part, and ready to close it out. This last slide now is a complete change. Not my work, but what I was thinking about when I was in that enclosure is I'm a bit of a dinosaur because some of the new technologies emerging. This was a link sent to me by a friend of mine, an IT guy, who cheerfully points out technologies to me that are gonna, he thinks will outmode what I do all the time. This is some software called Midjourney, as I understand it. And what it relies on is just keywords. And I think the keywords, it's like a list of memes and keywords and whatever. This one was something like gremlin, psychedelia, CGI, surrealism, blah, blah, blah. And this is what it spit out. I mean, it's just incredible. The access to a data bank of images and the ability to kind of synthesize and edit. But I leave that as a cautionary and somewhat frightening image for me, at least. And I think it wraps up.
Thanks a lot, Rob. We're going to head over right to Rick Leonardi and get him started. And again, if people have questions for Rob or Rick, please put them in the chat and we'll cover when Rick is done. So take it away, Rick.
No third degree for Rob? Huh, okay.
Not yet, buddy. No, I love everything you do. What's it? This is American in Paris, right? Yeah.
Go ahead, Rick.
This is my intro slide. Well,
I know.
About it a little bit. Basically, I graduated in 79, and submitted samples to Marvel that fall, and was hired by Marvel in January of 1980. Mark, you can just start clicking, roll. And so what I was given first was a so-called inventory job, which is basically a script that was bought on spec. It was not slated for publication at any fixed date, but it was, you know, a good tryout for a newbie like me. This is Thor 303. I went down and rented a room in Montclair, New Jersey. And for the duration of the job, I was going back and forth into Manhattan two or three times a week on the PATH train just to show progress and get a little tutelage. And the thing was finally published, I think, late that spring in 1980. But that was my debut. So free to go. I dumped that room in New Jersey, went back to Hanover, and this did a series of it's still probationary jobs, but it was bopping around from various things. This is a miniseries featuring the Vision and Scarlet Witch. Done in an apartment over the Village Green, and features these two characters for the first time as a domestic couple. And the interesting thing about this is that decades later, like last year, WandaVision comes out on Disney Plus, featuring these two characters as a domestic couple. Amazing. Go on. So then from there, I graduated to Cloak and Dagger, which is still the characters with whom I'm sort of most connected with. Cloak and Dagger are two characters, obviously. Dagger's the woman in white, and Cloak is the guy in the blue cape. That's the cover for the first issue. And on the right is a more recent redo, sort of evolution of style, you can see that. Go on. The interior page here is inked by Al Williamson, who is a legend in the business. An inker is a sort of a technical necessity, and roots go back as far as old engraving. But basically, a pencil original isn't going to print. You need something that's camera ready, which introduces the contribution of a guy who's either going to use a pen or a brush and a bottle of ink to translate, if he's doing the job right, translate the pencil drawing from the language of pencil into the language of ink. The guy's as legitimate an artist as I am. And we'll talk about that more later. On the right here is a Cloak and Dagger sketch I did, I don't know, 3 years ago, kind of like it. And on the right is a Cloak and Dagger ad that was done back in the era, but done with the inks of Terry Austin, who some of you may have heard of since he's sort of mostly connected with the X-Men. Oh, look, X-Men. So yeah, then I got going on some X-Men stuff through the middle 80s. And keep going. Keep clicking, Mark. You're doing fine. One of the X-Men, for example, is Colossus, who got his own graphic novel as the cover on the left, while also taking turns in his own book or in the Uncanny X-Men as a member of that team. On the right, well, on the left, we have inks by Craig Russell. On the right, by Dan Green. Here's a pencil sketch of Wolverine by me, and some inks of Wolverine by me, another X-Men character. Keep going. Keep clicking. Captain America came along as well in this period. This is a more recent Memorial Day kind of thing where I lifted some imagery from Anthony Brothers and the memorial wall. I sort of cut and pasted that in, but kind of like that one. Keep going. Keep going. Spider-Man, we did a bunch of that in this period as well. Here's a poster. Inks are again by Al Williamson. I think largely because of the success of that sort of work and that teaming up with Al Williamson on various projects, we were tapped to do the debut of Spider-Man 2099, which purports to be the future of Spider-Man 100 years from now. That's me doing it with my daughter on my lap. So this is like 1994 or so. Go on, Mark. You got it. Keep clicking, baby. Interior work. So these are. Wait, I'll go back. Too fast. Mark, go back. There you go. So this is interior work from Spider-Man 2099. Actual Xeroxes of pencils. This is bread and butter stuff. This is the kind of stuff that I do over and over and over again, week after week, year after year. You can see Spider-Man swinging along. He's just basically chasing down a helicopter being stolen by some bank robbers. Bank robber decides to cut the line that Spider-Man is swinging from. Spider-Man hits him in the face with a web blob first, then gets aboard the helicopter, knocks him heads, knocks out the pilot. And then fortunately, it turns out Spider-Man can fly a helicopter. Who knew? Lands the helicopter, and we go on from there. But that's typical continuity. That's kind of what I do. Here is a cover submission for an issue of Batgirl. So on the left, you see two possible sketches, but I submit the editorial, and they pick one and get the pencils on the right. Gorilla Grodd, an intelligent ape. Another Batgirl page. Actually, two more Batgirl pages, inked this time by Jesse Delpergang, who, for my money, is probably the best guy in the business, who unfortunately had to leave the business and get a real job. But beautiful stuff, just amazing. Beautiful judgment, wonderful line weights. Missed that guy. Keep going. Then follows some Nightwing. This is for Batgirl and Nightwing both are obviously for DC, which is the competitor to Marvel. I branched out over time. I wound up working for DC quite a bit. Inks by Bob Campanella on the right. Nightwing goes to a dance club, sneaks in, crawls through the rafters. Keep going, next page. Looks down. He's looking for a bomb. Turns out to be in the ladies' room. Turns out to be in a toilet paper dispenser. Then he has to make his way back out of the club, out the window, and hustles the bomb away to safety. But again, examples of continuity. A misconception that a lot of people have when they approach me and talk about comics is that comics must be fun because you get to draw whatever you want. The fact is, couldn't be further from the truth. A lot of times the story the story is so constrained, and the necessity of leading the reader in an inherent intelligent fashion from one panel to the next is so imperative that oftentimes there's only one panel that will do in any given situation, and the job really becomes one of finding that panel and then executing it. Placing the camera is 9/10 of the game, and frankly, it's the fun part of the job. Keep going. Yeah, then followed a Star Wars period. Star Wars, the license at the time was held by a company called Dark Horse, which is based out in Oregon. They had the rights to all the Dark Horse stuff, and as well, they had the rights to a bunch of Paramount stuff, we'll see in a minute. But one of the projects was a Darth Maul, Darth Vader, basically a 42-page lightsaber fight, which is kind of fun. Later, we did a story with Darth Vader himself, where he basically, for 6 issues, looks for a lost legion of stormtroopers. No one knows where they went, but he's on their trail, and he interrogates princesses and he jumps around doing impossible things using the Force, and it's very cool. And in a lot of ways, it was written by a guy who's a video game designer. And in a lot of ways, each issue is example of leveling up. It actually reads like a video game schedule almost. Another project featured this guy, General Grievous, who I think is in the second or third movie, Attack of the Clones or something like that. And is my first exposure to working with an NBA. If you're familiar with the character, familiar with the movie, there's a critical moment where Grievous, who's largely a kind of a cyborg, turns out to have, he's been making do with just two mechanical arms for most of the movie, and that one at one critical juncture, the arms split, and it suddenly has four, and he's wielding four lightsabers at once. This little detail was so closely guarded that they didn't tell us about it until we were set to go off the stage. And the whole thing was sort of governed by an NDA. We couldn't talk about it. Go on. I was approached subsequently at a New York Comic Con. Out of the crowd emerged a small publisher guy who was vouched for by a colleague of mine. With this project called Watson, he called it Watson and Holmes. And it was a reimagining of the Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson, only two guys from Harlem. And the idea was just perfect. I loved it. And we got going on it right straight away. These are a couple covers from various issues. And then I'm going to bore you with a whole bunch of continuity. Here is the sketch for very early on when we first meet John Watson, who is home from Afghanistan. He was a para-jumper for the Air Force, and he goes straight to work in an ER in Harlem. He's had a bad day, as you can see, lost a patient. And here comes another one through the door. And in this case, the patient is followed closely by this guy in a hat and dreadlocks, who's turns out to be a private investigator asking all kinds of questions about this guy's circumstance. Introductions follow. The guy in the hat turns out to be S. Holmes, private investigator, and hands Dr. Watson a card to that effect and leaves. Next day, Watson, curious, goes to Baker Street and to the address on the card. And it's Hudson's, what is it, Antiques and Vinyl or something like that. Knocks on the door, passes the kids, draped all over the front step with his brownstone in Harlem. These are the irregulars, it turns out. Meets Mrs. Hudson, who's a nice Jamaican lady. He takes him up to Holmes's apartment. And that's where the two of them start the case. Later, and much later in the case. These are scans of pencils, by the way. I'm dispensing with the inkers. I've been talking about inkers right throughout this. As time went on, it became obvious that inkers as a tribe were starting to vanish. All the inkers I've been working with were older gentlemen, who'd gotten their starts often in the 50s, and they weren't being replaced by the next generation. So it became sort of imperative to find a new way to make a crisp black and white image somehow mechanically. And these were early attempts at Xeroxing and then tricking out the actual pencils to find a black and white image crisp enough for line art. Anyway, so that's a cover. Somebody painted that, not me. Go on. Yeah, more Dark Horse stuff. Here's Aliens versus Predator. Inks, this time by Mark Pennington, who's actually kind of young. And I'm glad he's still around. From the same issue, the same Aliens versus Predator, you can see the contribution, the storytelling contribution that a colorist can make. And a colorist has got a, who's got a point of view and isn't shy about non-literal coloring, can make a huge contribution. Here you can see where the colorist has kind of separated foreground and background using just color, knocked out groups in the foreground in red, or in some cases in blue, and it's worked well with the silhouette work at the bottom right. Did some Batman. Batman showed up, has shown up in any number of jobs that I've done, but I have not ever drawn him in his own book, which is kind of a Moby Dick situation to me. The white whale, the one that got away. Here's an example of Batman showing up in somebody else's book. Superman, Martian Manhunter, Wonder Woman, Zatanna in the background. Keep going. Yeah. And got to do a little bit of Wonder Woman after time. This is a this is actually for a charity thing. The Heroes Initiative is a... The old guys in this business, I suppose myself included, really are not beneficiaries of anything like a company health plan or a retirement plan of any sort. So the Heroes Initiative steps in with contributions, and they run a fine charity. And the way they fund it is with auctioning off art like that. Here's two pages of continuity from the Wonder Woman episode where she goes to war. Like I say, these pages are scans of pencils. Some ink work has been added after, and this is the kind of refining of the technique over time. This starts to look more and more convincingly like an ink page. This is convincing enough, in fact, that I was able to sell it to DC as an ink page, even though it's mostly scanned pencils. And they didn't figure it out till after. The thing about not having an inker, unfortunately, is I really miss that second point of view on a lot of this artwork, but I suppose it's just a necessity going forward from here. Here's a small press effort featuring some Vikings. Page one, sketch on the left, inks in the middle, colors on the right. You can sort of see how comic books in a lot of ways is like putting a car together, you kind of ship things down the production line. Some more continuity I'll bore you with. The ship's being attacked with by the Kraken, tentacled monster. Vikings go in the water. The red cloak leader tries to fight this thing that's taking down his ship. Him there in the bottom right, handsome devil. He himself winds up in the drink. The ship goes down. You see the Kraken finally in the bottom left there. It's a hybrid of an octopus and a lobster. They're a swim and they wind up on this haunted island basically. They have a riddle contest with the Grim Reaper, who finally the Grim Reaper loses and gives them back their boat basically. Yeah. Anyway. Horak the Killer is this is an e-strip for the Edgar Rice Burroughs people. It's available by subscription. You know, there's a lot of junk on the site, but there's this as well. This is very early. I think this is strip number two, episode number two, and it's inked in the usual, this is inked very traditionally with brush and pen. And I got tired of that and started to do, again, bureaucracy with highlighting and cleanup and stuff like that. So this is stand pencils. And then this is the middle of episode 24 or something like that. By episode 48, which you see next is Korak is rescued with the enslaved city and needs a revolt of the slaves to restore the monarchy, basically. But this is an example of finally totally cleaned up pencil stand. And this technique, I was confident enough in this technique now. It's laborious because it involves penciling and then copying and then inking and then scanning and then putting the whole thing into Procreate for final cleanup. But I'm confident enough in the technique finally to go to, next slide, the graphic model, which is Blue Angel. This is 140 pages or so to come out by the U.S. Naval Institute Press. It's a military strip with a superhero in it. I'm not going to spoil it beyond that, but got a lot of detail, a lot of research, and again, all stands of pencils after ink. Features this character. Some of the action set aboard an aircraft carrier, some in the mountains of Afghanistan. Later on, we wind up in Iraq. Touches on actual historical events in some places. But of course, it's a totally made up story with a superpower. We're not going to talk about that part. There's a kind of an early poster shot just to sort of introduce the character a little bit. Onward. Oh, light. There's a close up. This is hot off the press. This showed up just yesterday from the colorist, who's now on page 42 or something like that. He's only got 100 pages to go. Here they are wandering down from the mountaintop into the sunset. Horrible things about that. But it'll turn out all right for her because, you know, we need her for the next episode. Night's falling. Put on the NVGs. And that's about right. It was supposed to come out this fall, but we're having supply chain issues. So it's going to be February 23rd of 2023. Now, fun sidebar kind of thing is throughout this 40-year history of publication, B-79s of one sort or another have been inserted into the comic books. It's kind of a, it's not, I haven't been as militant or as rigorous about it as, say, Al Hirschfeld was with his daughter Nina's name in the New York Times theater section, but same idea. So here's a bunch of them. Here's a bunch more. And I think I've got the most recent one is actually in a Korak strip on the side of an airplane. But there you go. Long way from the green, ladies and gentlemen. And that's the career right there. Anybody who is in the Huntsville area, Huntsville, Alabama, I'm going to be there. I'm getting on an airplane tomorrow. I'll be there Friday. Come on out. Let's visit.
Great. Thank you, Rick.
Sure.
We're going to jump right into the questions from the chat. And the first one is for you, Rick, which is from Gail Frawley, which is, where does your inspiration for these incredible stories, not to mention the astonishing artwork, come from?
Well, this ties back neatly into something we were talking about before. As a penciler, I'm kind of a, not a one-off, but I'm a fairly rare breed in that I just pencil. I haven't ever put on, until this graphic novel, I haven't put on any other hats. I haven't written my own stuff, or really haven't branched out into other specialties. I'm a pure pencil in that I get a story from a writer and then figure out how to shoot the story and then draw it. Often, you know, that doesn't sound, that makes it sound a little bit robotic and a little bit, you know, unimaginative. But the fact is, a lot of these stories need a lot of help. And very often, the writer is writing it at white heat and without due consideration of the poor benighted reader who may not be aware of the continuity, who may actually be picking up that title for the first time. So in a lot of cases, I find myself in the position of being an advocate for the reader. Properly speaking, that's my job, is actually to militate between the writer and the reader, make sure the reader can understand the story as clearly as possible. In that regard, if I'm doing my job right, like Rob was saying, I too kind of fade into the background a little bit. The stories should be paramount, not any marks I'm making, not any kind of big stylistic statements or, you know, in your face shots, that kind of stuff. That's not where it's at.
So here's a question from Gina Barreca to both of you, which is, when you were undergraduates at Dartmouth, were you certain that you would, what you'd be doing by now? That as young people, that you'd be doing what you're doing now?
I might start by assuming Rick might have been closer to that than me. I didn't even know I was going to major in art when I went to Dartmouth, but turned out the Hopkins Center kind of became my fraternity sophomore year. I was a GDI, but that was my frat. Wow. You know, and things like the Orozco mural, that had a huge impact on me in retrospect. And honestly, even when I graduated, I didn't know where it was going to take me. No, you can't look that far ahead. For me, it was life giving pushback and forcing me to do things. And the art I picked is one where it has a job. You know, I needed that. I needed the direction, I think, and to find variety within a given task. And that took me years. I'm still figuring that out. But anyway.
I pretty much always wanted to do comics since I was eight. Or something like that. So Rob, you picked up all this technique on your own. I mean, none of this, you didn't learn any of this really.
Well, it's true. I mean, I'd never had really teachers, honestly, that I thought were better painters than me. For instance, I never really took a painting class, honestly. So in that, those.
Well, there wasn't, right?
Well,
it didn't exist.
That those trompe l'oeil were under another kind of category. I think it was like a design class or something. I don't even remember. But and the teacher, though he elicited Matt Wysocki good results, was not a painter himself. A photographer, actually, from Yale. The whole department was pretty much Yale. I don't know. I went to the Art Students League. I drew the figure a lot. And I had looked at a lot of art. As a kid, Doré's Bible, you know, the dark and the light, Renaissance art. So that stuff got into my head and maybe into my hand earlier than I knew, you know. You're right. I learned on my own pretty much. I think American artists in general are self-taught. The whole tradition of the academy and the guild is all broken down, you know. Guys used to start with plastering a wall and learn how to go from there. And now it's you get what you can, where you can, and try to make the most of it, you know.
So I've got two questions, one for Rick and one for Rob. From Rick, the question is, let me see if I've got this right. Have you worked in TV series or feature film animation? And then for Rob, it's more of how long does it take research to do your work for a painting, a mural?
I'll go first because this answer is short. I'm working on a movie now, but I can't talk about it.
Over to you, Rob.
Well, sometimes a long time and others not. You hope that the research goes quickly and is adequate to get the work done expeditiously. Today, the options are so huge with the internet and stuff. So, whereas I used to go to the library, you know, Africa, and do an African thing. Now I'm always looking for the next image around the corner, and I go through thousands of images. And so in a sense, it's image inflation. It's a little bit of paralysis by sheer profusion. And yet the option is there to get better research than you had before. And so one speeds it up, but can slow it down if you spend too much time in that phase of it. You know what I mean? And I like research. I mean, I love, there's a point where I have to force myself to stop, honestly.
And Rob, do you do most of your work on site, or do you in the studio and transport, or how does that work from a logistics perspective?
Really, I didn't really explain that too well, but you know, it started out almost on exclusively on site. Then it became large scale canvas in the studio, shipped and installed, like heavy duty wallpaper. And then it became scale paintings that were turned into that wallpaper, which started out as vinyl and then canvas, full scale fabric pieces. So the possibilities are getting greater, the cost's coming down, the quality's going up. And it saves me, like, if I can work digitally, you know, as you get older, my field involves a lot of physical stress, you know. And that's, as it happens, that's what I'm doing again now. I've been sort of pulled out of retirement from that field. I'm working on big walls, like a fighter coming out for one last big fight. And it does tax you, you know, carrying 5 gallon buckets up the scaffolding and doing this and that, and putting the scaffolding up while you're doing it, you know. So I relish in some ways then getting back to scale paintings and the smaller scale work turning into mural.
And how do you go from a regular size piece of art to imagining it to a huge scale? I mean, how do you do the scaling?
Well, you grid it, basically. The way I used to do it was I'd grid up my study and then paint it. You create a scale grid where you can locate the outlines, basically, the shapes. You never get lost when you're up on the wall because you have the scale painting in front of you, the little grids, and you follow the drawing on, say, maybe a 2 foot grid, something like that on the wall. But when you're actually doing paintings for reproduction, you have to be aware, of course, of the height of people, the size of the heads when they are reproduced. You know what I mean? You can't be wrong with the people and right with the landscape or something, you know, with a forest and then suddenly a group of Native Americans where their heads are too big. So you have to be very conscious of that. You know, you get better with practice, I guess. But you know, it's all a matter of measuring and just checking yourself, you know, and not getting going off the deep end.
So here's a question for both of you: as far as your undergraduate experience with faculty and fellow classmates or fellow artists, Rick, to you first. I mean, what impact has that had on your career?
Anything else? Well, you know, I have. Two or three professors that, you know, I consider kind of beloved figures. Bugsy, you know, Varujan Bogosian, I think made an enormous impression on me. But the biggest impression on me he made was afterwards. Like I said, I lingered in Hanover for a period of years after I graduated. And I actually bumped into him at the Hop Snap Bar. Some years afterwards, and you know, I was already launched and doing work, and he was curious about that. And we sat and had coffee, and he was asking about the comics and all that sort of stuff. And he passed this comment to me about, and it really wasn't meant as any kind of judgment. I don't think it was any judgment at all, but he wanted to make sure that I was aware of what was critical in art was that I have a point of view. And that really stuck with me. It's like, what does he mean point of view? I've wrestled with that for years and years and years and years. What did he mean by that exactly? And then years later, I relayed that very story to a fan who was asking me about some stuff. And, Chris Claremont, who is the big writer of the X-Men, he's, you know, semi-legendary character in my field anyway, overheard that. And I said, well, and I told this fan the story about point of view, and then I explained that, you know, that what was really critical in penciling was that you make the story as clear as possible. You lead the reader by the hand, just what I was saying about advocacy before. And then the fan went off, and then Chris turned to me and he said, you know, I think that's your point of view, you know, this idea you have of clarity, that's your point of view. And I think, holy smokes, you know, my life, I saw Baruzin Bogosian before my eyes, Darren.
And Rob?
Well, like Rick, Professor Bogosian was a big influence for me. I took his basic design class in the fall of my sophomore year, and I was so glad it was the fall because we ended up doing leaf collages, taking colored leaves and sticking them together. The class had started inauspiciously for me. We were doing dipping corks in ink and kind of making accumulative geometric type images. But when we got to the leaf, it was like painting with color. And I sort of, it was liftoff for me using light. And the other projects, he was complimenting me on my invention, taking something and switching it, changing it around. And that encouraged me. That's a kind of, but I didn't quite follow that in my actual career, but it was the starting point for me. I also enjoyed Ros Richards' printmaking classes a lot. They opened up possibilities that I wish I'd explored further, just using the print, separating yourself a little bit that from the actual first image and then subsequent images by the process. You don't mess around too much right in front of your face, you take a print. And then in the English department, Don Pease was a professor he liked what I wrote and I liked what he was saying. So it was win-win, you know. It was that kind of thing where if you get encouragement, you know, for any source, it's influential. And of course the camaraderie with classmates and that was big too. I'm surprised I didn't see you at Dartmouth, Rick, after we graduated, because I was up there quite a bit too, working, doing stuff. I got to work for artists in residence sort of as a post-graduation job before I went overseas. And anyway, glad to reacquaint myself with you and your work. And if you get up to Boston, by all means, give me a holler.
So I just have one more question, but before I do that, I want to thank both of you again for the amount of time you've spent in helping prepare this. I know I've learned a tremendous amount. And as you know, I mean, we've left a lot of stuff on the cutting room floor, you know, so really try to select the best. But before I hand it over to Ben, I just wanted to ask, are there any last pearls of wisdom that each of you want to share with the classmates? So first to you, Rob, I mean, just insights, perspectives, final words.
A lot of what was on the cutting room floor is about our kind of larger purpose, what we think we're doing means and stuff like that. I guess I want to celebrate nature as a kind of not a new religion exactly, but something to be celebrated, preserved. The phrase that Thoreau's famous for, in wildness is the preservation of the world. There's a lot to think about there, what he actually meant, but I think it means we should try to be like nature, not try to control it too much. We tend to get into trouble when we do. And I don't know, we could go back to Lascaux, because I think they understood that idea, you know. A lot to talk about. I'd hand it over to Rick right now.
Well, yeah, and that was the one question that I actually had prepped for you, Rob, was you know, whether or not working on that Lascaux piece, whether you felt any particular kinship with that original mural guy 17,000 years ago.
No, absolutely. I think so. Yeah, I could go on. We're maybe out of time, but because yes, it was some of the first art we know about on a big scale, and we don't enjoy it just for its documentary value. It was kind of aspirational art. It tried to create reality. I think the artist wanted to affect the hunt and do pure success. I get a little bit of that feeling myself in a different way. You know, I am a cave painter. The caves are different, but I'm trying to appeal on some level in the same way.
Right. I love that. That's great. Yeah, I mean, to a lesser extent, I think I'm in an ancient tradition as well. I mean, the business of telling a story in sequential pictures. You can find forerunners as far back as the Bayeux tapestry and, you know, Roman art even. There's even Egyptian hieroglyphics in a way are sequential in some fashion. So, you know, telling stories in a sequence of pictures is an ancient art form. And I'm happy to be the latest expression of it.
Well, I think you're an excellent exemplar of that tradition, and the language of the body, the way you throw the body around, people understand emotionally what that figure. They probably couldn't do it themselves, but there's a kind of whole language that, like you say, goes back through the Renaissance, where they were borrowing bodies from the ancient world and repositioning.
Yeah, I'd be remiss if I didn't give a shout out to the Italian LSA. That 3 months in Florence, going from the Uffizi to the Bargello and back, was enormously formative. I mined what I learned in that 3 months. I mined to huge success writing papers over in the art history department. Boy, they were impressed. Like, you know, I was dropping stuff on them like they hadn't heard before, which is shocking because, you know, just go there. It's right there.
Let me just say one last thing about what you said there, because I was going to say the Florentines, you know, their thing was disegno or drawing. It's what you do, the penciling. It's the backbone, which they valued over colorito, which the Venetians, they looked down on that as just mere effect and kind of, you know, and I was going to ask you, we can get into that later about if you ever have chafe at what the colorists do to your work or the inkers, but let's leave that for a future discussion, I guess.
Yeah.
at our next reunion. So continue the conversation at our next mini reunion. But anyway, thank you, Rob and Rick. And thank you all, but I pass it back to Sitting on the Fence Central with Ben Riley.
Yeah, over to you, Ben. Mark. Thank you, Mark. Mark did so much work. All these images were on his computer, and God, I never could have done that. So thank you, Mark. Thank you, Rick. Thank you, Rob. I'm so pleased. I've been an admirer of you guys' work for a long time, and so glad to do it. So thank you all. Great to see all your smiling faces. Go 79. We'll plan another one of these in late June. I have some ideas, and I'm going to call one of you guys to help me out maybe. So thanks all. Take care.
Great. Thanks, guys.
Bye.
Bye. Take care.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Hey, Rob. Thanks, Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Mark. Good work.
Thanks. Great. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Rob and Rick.
Thank you.
Seth and Rob's wife. They miss him in Boston, I imagine, but there you go.
All right, you guys.
Anyway, lots of fun.
Nice cat, Steve.
Yeah, it's good. Steve's on mute.
I got two. I'm off mute. Man. There we go.
I saw that cat.
Burr. Look what Burr's got there.
I was 15 years old when they killed off Gwen Stacy. Spider-Man's girlfriend. It's like
that was the last Spider-Man I ever read, man. When they killed her, that was it. I was
done. Yeah. I mean, what were they thinking of? You know.
Well, it's
big
topic. But when a writer becomes a character in the story, you know, what am I going to do to Spider-Man this month? You know, when they get that kind of attitude, it's all over. It's done. You know.
Yeah, well, it was kind of shocking. It was like all of a sudden that when you're 15 years old and your world kind of changes. It's like, how does that happen? I mean, she's, you know, lovely and nice. And what kind of world do we live in? Or does Marvel?
He winds up with Mary Jane. Come on.
Oh, yeah. Anyway, it's great. Great listening to you guys. All good.
Thank you, guys.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, guys.
Okay, take care all.
Right. Thank you all.
Thanks, guys. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thanks, Ben.
Later,
man.
Bye.
Bye.
See y'all.
Okay. Bye. Signing off. Goodbye. See you, Tom. Bye.